Hello, everybody, and welcome back to a five questions from Michael Garron Hospital on all matters related to COVID. And today it's my pleasure to invite back Dr. Janine McCready, who's an infectious diseases doctor at Michael Garron, and who over the past several months has gained a lot of expertise in treating people with COVID. So welcome back, Dr. McCready, and thanks for spending time with me today.
Thank you.
So Dr. McCready, I have five questions, and they really do relate to what we now know and understand about COVID. So I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to start with question number one.
Sounds great.
I've heard reports that people can get reinfected with COVID-19. Is this true?
It's a good question. So I think what the question is probably referring to is there's been a lot of reports in the media about people being reinfected. But when we look at those cases, really, it's a question of the test that's being done. So when we're looking at COVID-19, the main diagnostic test right now is something called a PCR test. So that's looking for genetic material of the virus, but it can't differentiate between live virus and dead virus. So if you did serial testing on someone that had the virus and then is improving, it's hard to know at what point the virus is no longer infectious anymore, unless you actually culture the virus and try to grow it and see if it's still alive. So in some of these reports, people have had negative tests, and then if you test them a few days later, they might have a positive test again. And that's not indicative of a new infection. It just means that they may have had some very low levels of virus that they were shedding, potentially even dead virus that they were shedding, and they're just picking it up on this test again. So that's one of the limitations of the testing with this, and that can lead to a false positive. In terms of whether we know whether people, you know, a few months out or a few years out could be reinfected with this virus, obviously it's too early to know since it's just in its infancy. And there is a lot of research being done looking at different antibody tests in order to determine, is everyone that's exposed to it and that gets sick, do they mount an antibody response? And how long does that response last? And is it protective? So that's going to help us know if people can truly get reinfected and then at what point that can happen.
Okay. So no clear answers yet.
As clear as mud.
So the next question is, if a person dies from COVID or with COVID-19, should they be cremated?
So in terms of after death, with COVID-19, there doesn't have to be any specific, very specialized care for the body in terms of whether they are cremated or buried. So funeral homes know what steps that they can take. But from an infection control perspective, once you know we safely pass on the body to a funeral home, they have their processes and they are able to do whatever the wishes are of that individual.
Okay. So this is a question we get from a lot of our staff. And that is, if they work with caring for COVID positive patients, should they be living in a separate area of their house in order to protect their family from COVID-19, and is showering and washing their hands enough to protect their families when they go home?
Right. So that's a great question. And I mean, it's something that I think all of us have thought about and struggled with at some point in this pandemic at different stages. And I think the most important thing to remember with this is that when we wear our PPE appropriately and we're donning it and doffing it appropriately, that will keep us safe. So if you feel that you've had a lapse in your ability to use that PPE and you haven't worn it, you accidentally, you know, take your mask off in the room, and I don't know how that would happen, but if you do something where you're breaching what the protocol should be, then you have to think about whether or not you're putting, you know, you're at risk. But if you're following all the protocols and all the safety things that we put in place at the hospital, then I don't think you're at any greater risk than any member of the community, because you actually have an extra layer of protection to make sure that you're not getting that virus. And obviously that includes the appropriate mask, the face shield, and hand hygiene. which is, you know, so important. And all of us need a reminder to make sure that as this goes on, that we're not getting complacent and not forgetting about that, and not forgetting about the proper doffing of the PPE and contaminating ourselves. To give some personal spin to it, I mean, I have two young children and I still cuddle with them and they still end up in my bed most nights. And, that's the kind of the what's keeping me going. And then that, if I had to separate myself from that for however long this is going to go on, I don't think that would be a reasonable approach. And certainly I do shower when I get home and I make sure I've washed my hands and I wash my phone device in case I've contaminated it. But I feel safe cuddling with my kids. And if I developed symptoms, I would be, you know, alert for that and I would go get tested. But in the absence of that, I think I trust the PPE I'm wearing and I think that that's keeping me safe. And I've probably seen as many cases as anyone here. So I do feel comfortable still doing with that approach.
Great. I'm sure a lot of people will feel reassured based on your personal story. People with COVID-19 get very, very sick. And I've been hearing that a ventilator can do more harm than good for COVID-19 patients, as everyone's lungs react differently. Is that true? And how are we treating the sickest of the COVID-19 patients now?
So another great question, and I think it's complicated. So early on in this pandemic, a lot of the approach was to intubate people early, and that was thought to be, you know, kind of the best strategy for treatment as well as for protecting healthcare workers. As we saw out of cases in New York and across the states, a lot of people did well without being intubated, and they actually did better on a strategy called Airvo. So it's a high heated flow nasal cannula. And with combined with that, in terms of, there's a new study that just came out yesterday with people self-proning. So what that means is people lying on their bellies on this special type of oxygen. So some people, when they come into hospital or as we see how they're doing, they deteriorate too quickly, and the Airvo or that high heated flow nasal cannula oxygen isn't enough to support their breathing, so they still require intubation. But in many of our people, we've been able to use that as a first strategy and actually avoid intubation for those people, especially combined with them laying on their bellies or on their side. And we've had, you know, people recover, be discharged from the ICU, and eventually be discharged home. In terms of whether the ventilator itself is damaging to the lungs and whether that is, you know, not a good option, again, I wouldn't say that. I would say it's complicated, and certainly when someone needs to be intubated and ventilated, it can be life-saving in these situations. Each person is individually evaluated by the intensive care doctor and their extraordinary knowledge of the ventilator and the physiology of the lungs, and they implement specific ventilation strategies for each individual patient in order to minimize any damage to the lungs and maximize the chance that they're going to survive. Because it's the impact of the virus, and it's the viruses sets off this response within some people called ARDS, or an acute respiratory distress syndrome. And so all the experts are taking our knowledge of ARDS at baseline and also combining that with new knowledge that we're gaining on a daily basis with COVID to come up with an individualized approach for each and every patient we see.
Great. Thank you. So my last question is, there have been reports of successful antiviral medications for COVID-19. Do you think we're getting close to a cure, and are we involved in any trials of different treatments for COVID?
So no easy questions here. So that's another good one. And I won't give any Trumpian advice today. I think in terms of the cure question, there is no cure yet. There's no magic bullet. There are definitely numerous trials ongoing over the world. And there was actually just yesterday two trials announced that were released with some preliminary information on a drug called Ritisimir. And there's not that, it's still, the jury is still out, is what we're finding with a lot of these things. And we're we know that there's bigger trials still in progress, and I'm very curious and kind of anxiously awaiting that information. And there's multiple other different medications that people are trialing on the virus at different levels. Here at Michael Garron, we are involved in some treatment trials at the level right now where we've been applying. Health Canada has recently just approved one of the trials we're doing, and then we're working at getting it through our REB, and it would start in our outpatient population, like most drugs have to first, to ensure that it is safe. And then once you know that you have enough safety data, you can move into the inpatient world and test it on people that are more critically ill. So we're actively pursuing, you know, every opportunity for research and for new therapies on that. But there is no magic bullet yet. And I think, you know, there are millions of scientists over the world looking into this, and I'm hopeful that we will have some better answers soon.
Great. Thank you so much for taking those questions, Dr. McCready. I'm very relieved that we have such smart and compassionate doctors on the front line like you, who are staying really up to date with all the evidence that's coming out and figuring out how best to treat the patients we have at Michael Garron Hospital. So thanks for all that you're doing. And I'm sure you'll be back again for another 5 questions before too long. So with that, have a great day. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Sarah.